An interesting topic, basically given to us, playing with the labs. So it's again, we will be focusing on some of the cases which we'll go through and we will discuss about in this lecture about approach to different infections, how to interpret various laboratory reports, various cultures and various other reports, and rational use of antibiotics based on that, and what's the role of imaging in these difficult conditions. So first case, basically a 10-year-old female who was admitted in ICU with history of fever, acute onset, high grade fever, and then developed abdominal pain, vomitings, non-bilious, non-projectile, and also had loose stools, 4 to 5 per day, watery. But there was no history of rapid breathing, seizures, altered sensorium, decreased urine output, rash, or bleeding, or any jaundice. On triage, she had abnormal breathing and abnormal appearance, and skin circulation was abnormal. So she was unstable with life-threatening. Our main was her GCS was okay. Blood sugar was normal. Respiratory rate was 38 with increased efforts, and she had crackles on auscultation. Heart rate was high with CFT of 2 to 3 seconds. BP was 73 by 44. Central pulses good, but peripheral were poor with cool peripheries. She was febrile with pallor, rash being present, periorbital puffiness. So she was having hypotensive shock and respiratory distress. So she was classified as resuscitation. So we started her on a nasal prong oxygen, gave a normal saline bolus, and also started IV ceftriaxone. So this was the child, the weight, the anthropometry was normal, was febrile, pallor was there, bilateral subconjunctival hemorrhages, puffiness, generalized lymphadenopathy, and there was an scar present over the abdomen. So this was the scar which was observed in the lower part of the abdomen. This almost we have discussed. So this was a child with 10-year female child, acute febrile illness, GI involvement with pallor, hypotensive shock, distress, generalized lymphadenopathy, conjunctival hemorrhages, capillary leak, eschar, bilateral Krebs, hepatomegaly. So very commonly we see this kind of presentation in our emergency. So we kept a diagnosis of various tropical infections, scrub typhus being prominent because of the eschar, and then other possibilities were also kept. For shock, it was managed with adrenaline, started on doxycycline, and was shifted to PICU at 6 hours. So Dr. Suresh, these were the investigations which we found. Hemoglobin was 9, TLC was 15,600, BLC was 64 of polys, platelets were 57,000. MP test was negative. We have a sodium of 132, potassium 4.3, urea 88, creatinine 1.2. We have slightly raised OTPTs, bilirubin 9, calcium 9.1, phosphate 4.3. And this was the chest X-ray we had. So, Dr. Suresh, can you comment on these investigations? What can we make out from this?
Sorry, sir, I think you need to unmute yourself.
Yeah, sorry. Thank you, sir. So this child is a typical case of tropical fever. And if you go by history and examination, it is fitting into a scrub typhus. And at presentation, he had respiratory distress and hypotensive shock. Investigation showed that there is some degree of anemia with leukocytosis and neutrophilic response is there, and thrombocytopenia is there. On biochemical investigation, transaminitis, OT more than PT. Skeletal and soft tissue shadows, but there is definitely increase in parenchymal shadows, and cardiac sellout seems to be normal with.
Okay, so we have in these
the investigation simple. That is
So this is simple, like you have some high TLC, thrombocytopenia, some raised liver enzymes, and X-ray is being abnormal. So any child with the tropical infections, it is expected that these kind of picture will be there. You can have DIC like picture, you can have a neutrophilic response, and you can have some liver involvement in tropical infections, and lung infection can be there. So in spite of starting a doxycycline, the fever was persisting and the shock worsened, and epinephrine was already going on. Norepinephrine was added. But respiratory distress worsened, requiring ventilation, and liver parameters also worsened. So this is what we did, Dr. Dhirin. So these are the few other reports we have. So we have an HB which was fluctuating from 9 to 6, somewhere varying between that. TLC was gradually falling down. From 9,000, it came down to around 3,400. Platelets always were low, and they were always, the lowest was 8,000 by day 5. And you have a INR which was worsening, and you have a PTI which was low, and prothrombin time was also increased. And you have urea creatinine which was high, OTPT was worsening. So how do we interpret these reports in spite of we starting an adequate therapy in this case?
Yeah. Can I comment on the previous two slides?
One yes, the X-ray. Yes. You can.
Can,
yes.
Can you go, shall I go two, back? Shall two I go slide back? Back? Is yeah. a, before this? This one, one is that because you said that lab includes X-ray also. Two comments here. And one is that endotracheal tube is little bit in. Means the gap between the yes. carina and lower is just 0.5 centimeter. And secondly, the line, center line is also a little bit in. I mean, normally we expect from the carina two disc spaces, two disc means yeah. two vertebral
body
below.
So I will point
below.
Out here, this is the center yeah. line here. And this is the ET tube, what Dr. Yes, Dhirin yes. is trying to say. Okay.
Yes, 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 yes. So one thing is that, so this is also important when we play with the labs. And now move ahead. Second X-ray is perfect except the center line. But this is, we need not to change the center line. But we need to keep in mind that, okay, our center line is a little bit lower. If some complication develops, one can focus on that. One thing. Secondly, it's a classical pulmonary edema. And at this time means when we were giving fluid bolus, and one can make use of ultrasound, which you must have done. But just yes. to make a point that ultrasound use can help in the deciding fluid responsiveness. Now we move forward.
Just before we move forward, can you just, for the sake of participants, what will you find in the ultrasound in this kind of pulmonary yeah. edema if it is
yeah.
there?
See, everybody knows that more you give fluid, and if fluid is given unnecessarily, that is not taking into circulation in increasing the, you can say, fluid responsiveness or perfusion, that it increases the morbidity and mortality. Fine. So in ultrasound and echocardiography, inferior vena cava, because this patient is intubated, sedated, paralyzed, or not much having a spontaneous respiration, if you find your IVC is getting distended, distensibility mm-hmm. index is more than 18%, likely that this patient is not going to respond to the fluid. Secondly, mm-hmm. look at the contractility of the heart. That is very important guide in these type of patients. So these two points, along with B lines on the lung ultrasound, though in this X-ray is sufficient to say there is a pulmonary edema. So in these three findings are there, likely that these patients should not be given more fluid, more inotrope should be given as it is done in this patient.
Perfect. So I would say means ultrasound in ICU or in any ER or any setting nowadays is basically a very handy hands-on tool, which can give you a very instant information, like Dr. Dhirin has said. In fact, X-rays may take time to get it done. So ultrasound is very easy to do. So that's why I have included imaging as a one of the labs only as a part of this. Now yeah, coming yeah. back
now,
to this.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Now, looking at this, it means the history and HR looks like a case of scrub typhus, fine?
Yes.
Or something like a dengue who is landing on some complication later in stage, like means something like hyperferritinemic stage, or you can say some inflammation is persisting even after day 7. Normally, mm-hmm. when you give doxycycline, these patients respond within 48 hours. And you don't expect these type of courses despite of normalization of blood urea and creatinine. Now there can be two causes which is leading to persistence of problem. One is liver dysfunction is not getting okay.
Yes.
I think lot of disturbances are there.
Can we please mute those who are, yes, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So now if I analyze what is happening in this patient, your OT is more than PT. So it is an hypoxemic derived liver dysfunction. Fine, not a hepatotropic virus. Second, these are persisting and these are worsening, and that is also manifested by PTINR. Okay, yes. And also fibrinogen is a hypofibrinogenemic state. If you see at day 5, it's 0.8. Now yes. Come to the platelet. Platelet itself indicating that the patient is not improving and there's an inflammatory state that is persisting and consumption is there. Also look at the total leukocyte count. Especially if you look at the day 5, day 6, it is persistently low. So there yes. are 2-3 series which are indicating that there is something that is not improving and some inflammatory state that is persisting, what I could say at this stage.
Yeah, okay. Balaji, you have anything to add in this or you agree with this?
What Dr. Just one point. I just yeah. want to see the ferritin also. What is okay. happening to the ferritin and yes. In this patient?
That's a good point. Yes. So we'll come to that. Dr. Balaji?
Dr. Balaji, you are muted.
Muted. Hmm.
Yeah. Is it audible now?
Yes.
Yeah, fine. So, yeah, I completely agree with Dr. Giren sir and Dr. Suresh. So, in this scenario, in a child whom we have a proper diagnosis, like a test car and possible scrub titers and classical multi-organ failure, we have seen the kid in the second week of illness. And when things don't go as expected, like usually we see the response in 48 hours of doxycycline, but the child is worsening. So, two things can happen. Either there is some co-infection, which is quite common in our setup, or there is some complication due to the primary infection, which as Giren said, inflammatory cascade that is got unleashed. So we need further investigations.
Dr. Balaji, your voice is getting echoing. You know, it's not very clear audible. And can you try something, some other audio? Is it true, Dr. Arun?
His yes, voice there is not very clear. Lot of echo in Balaji's room.
Okay, now,
or? I think double. I think cell phone also you aren't. I think dual.
No, Robin is only one device.
One device, no. Okay, okay.
Looks like one phone is Mulla is speaking and second is Balaji is speaking. So both are speaking.
Is it still echoing now or is it fine now? Better.
It's almost same. Only anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, let's continue. Hmm.
So,
excuse me, sir. Please don't use the earbud, Bluetooth earbud. You'll get echo. You better go for earphone.
He was using that.
Okay. So, in this scenario, like, there are two possibilities that can be considered. One is either a co-infection that is there, that is present in the child, or it is the complication of the primary infection. So, the scrub titers is well known that they can end up in hyperferritinemic sepsis, infection-associated hemophagocytosis. So that is one thing that we definitely need to consider, especially with worsening organ failures, progressive pancytopenia, and definitely worsening liver
dysfunction. So these are the possibilities that I would consider.
This is much better. But last
part, now it
suddenly
is
improved. Okay. So I think we, all the panelists agree to this, that there is a gradual worsening happening in this case. And especially by day 5, it was the extreme of this worsening was there. So either it is the complication of the primary disease or some other secondary infection or something else is happening. So further investigations, like Dr. Dhiren asked, ferritin was 11,000. You have fibrinogen 0.6. Bone marrow showed marked hemophagocytosis. Echo was showing ejection fraction of just 35%. And you have a scrub IgM was positive. Other cultures were sterile and other tropical infection workup was also negative. So Dr. Suresh, what would you comment on this now?
So definitely this child had evidence clinically, fever is persisting, cytopenias are there, and the liver dysfunction is also gradually worsening as highlighted previously. And when we did workup for hyperferritinemia or secondary HLH, it showed that ferritin is very high. And there is evidence of hemophagocytosis on bone marrow examination. And these make that this child fulfill almost all the criteria for HLH, except we don't have values for NK cell activity and CD25 levels. So rest of the criteria are fulfilled. In addition, the ejection fraction is quite low, which could be a reason for the shock in this child. And after boluses, he went into pulmonary edema. So this could be the reason myocardial dysfunction is there. And scrub IgM is positive. So all this makes this child as a case of scrub typhus with secondary HLH.
Great. So thinking the same, he was started. What treatment is there, Dr. Dhiren, for HLH? Means what is advised for hyperferritinemia or HLH?
I think steroid and IVIG, these are the two main thing, and especially secondary to infection. If it would have been secondary to some autoimmune disease, then DEXA would have been the first choice.
Yes. So thinking the same, methylprednisolone was started and was given means from day 4, day 5, when we had the maximum worsening, when we got the other reports and the workup. So he started showing improvement. And there was gradual improvement, and it had a remarkable recovery was there. He was extubated, and then this fever, cytopenia, liver dysfunction started improving, and he was discharged by day 10. So that is what the importance of seeing all these labs and the clinical correlation is very important. So Dr. Balaji, when should we start suspecting HLH in these kind of cases, infections?
Yeah, see, that is a very valid question. So whenever things don't go in the way that we expect, so then we need to definitely think about any complication of the primary problem. So as said, whenever there is a worsening organ failures, that is when shock is not improving, when and especially when there is worsening liver failure, liver dysfunction, then we always need to suspect that there could be HLH, and the subtle clinical clues will be progressive cytopenia, thrombocytopenia, and leukocytopenia. And as well as if there is other markers like hypofibrinogenemia that can aid it, and again hyperferritinemia. One interesting thing with scrub typhus is if identified early, I think this child landed up with us at the second week, like day 8 or day 9. So that is the probable reason why the inflammatory cascade was already set up. With scrub typhus and HLH, when identified early, just the doxycycline or appropriate chemotherapy of the primary disease itself is sufficient. So many a times, okay, these children do well with just the appropriate antimicrobial. But if there is worsening organ failure, worsening liver dysfunction, worsening shock, then obviously we need to treat. And as said, infection-associated conditions, IV gamma or IVIG is nowadays being increasingly employed.
Okay. So Dr. Suresh, how do you diagnose HLH or hyperferritinemic syndromes?
Sir, for diagnosis of HLH, we follow HLH 2004 criteria. But in presence of, like in our country or in countries with the tropical location, tropical infections are most common cause of sepsis, and then sepsis, hyperferritinemic sepsis, and HLH. This is a continuum of illness. But these are the HLH 2004 criteria is what we follow. And the first criteria is like it's not always available at the presentation. So it's not like applicable always. And we follow set of 8 criteria. And out of these 8 criteria, we need to fulfill at least five criteria, like fever, organomegaly, cytopenias, hypertriglyceridemia or hypofibrinogenemia, hemophagocytosis on bone marrow aspirates, and there should be low or absent natural killer cell activity, and elevated ferritin and elevated soluble CD25 levels.
Great. So in this child, we had fever, we had cytopenias, we had low fibrinogen, we have hemophagocytes on the bone marrow, and we have a high ferritin. So these are fulfilled, means it's a classical case of an HLH. Dr. Dhiren, you commented something on the infection-induced HLH and autoimmune HLH. So what are these means, primary HLH or familial HLH, which is the term, and secondary HLH, like the infection-associated? Can you elaborate further on that? And
As an intensivist, not an hematologist, I would like to simplify what I have understood over 15 years. One is congenital HLH that is induced by some, that got exacerbated by some, infection. Even COVID can induce HLH in any given patient. And these patients usually present within 1 to 2 years of life. And they typically behave like any other HLH, but the problem is with the killer cells, so the type and the quality that matters. And these patients, you will find that the congenital HLH marker like soluble CD25, and these are the typical marker. And then slide the molecular diagnosis can be made. One, bone marrow transplant is an answer. Second is the infection induced. Now this infection induced infection per se, or some patients with like SLE, or some patient with autoimmune disease, some patient with malignancy, these can go into HLH. And when these patients having some autoimmune or immune-mediated diseases, they land up in HLH, then steroid, and usually hematologists prefer DEXA, and your rheumatologists prefer methylprednisolone as a first choice. Mm-hmm. When we talk about infection, like in this patient, infection-induced HLH, primary drug of choice which we prefer is an IVIG and steroid both, and because they are immunocompromised also, so we take care of both. So this is my understanding and about the HLH.
So Dr. Balaji, you want to add anything on this? And one more point is that any role of chemotherapy in HLH, like etoposide or vincristine, people have used, or in what kind it is being used?
Yeah, so basically the majority of children primary HLH, they do present at a much earlier age. So now the understanding is that there is some problem in their the apoptosis pathway itself, which predispose them to HLH like state when there's an infectious trigger. So especially in young infants, like less than 1 year of age, a child presents with classical fever, cytopenia, organomegalies. Upfront, we tend to send the genetic workup for the HLH. And once infections, common infections are ruled out, especially like EBV, CMV, these are some of the infections, PARVO, these are some of the infections that can present as HLH-like picture, especially in young infants. So once these are clearly ruled out, especially in young infant, we tend to start them on chemotherapy with etoposide, cyclosporine, and dexamethasone. That the usual HLH 2004 protocol that is still followed. And as once mutation is proven, of course, hematopoietic stem cell transplant will be the answer in this setup.
Okay. So one last question, Dr. Suresh, before we move to the next case. There are different terminologies like MAS, macrophage activation syndrome, HLH, hyperferritinemic syndrome. So are they all the same, or there is any difference between these different terminologies?
Yeah, I think what I feel is different people label them differently. There may be some minor differences in pathogenesis or molecular pathways. But ultimately, the manifestations and clinical features, biochemical manifestation, they are almost similar. So it's like macrophage activation syndrome for hematologist and HLH for hematologist, and hyperferritinemic states for intensivists. So I think these are different. What you want to label this condition as?
Okay, great. So I think we move to the next case. So this is
one point, Dr. Arun.
Yes.
I think all this MISC is also some form of HLH. I think after some time, you will find they are almost common diseases and with varied manifestation, with different type of cytokines release, and that's why different organs gets involved.
I totally agree, because HLH, or this is basically hyperinflammation. So MISC is also hyperinflammation of the infection which the body is reacting to. So it is also maybe one of the variant of this. So moving forward, this is a 4.5-year-old child who presented with polyuria and polydipsia with vomiting, abdominal pain, and altered sensorium. I think a very classical history for any child to present with of diabetes and DK. So could be one of, means a very, maybe the clear cut. So we'll not spend much time on this with no history of burning micturition, cough, ear discharge. Was taken to the local hospital, given IV fluids, medication, but the sensorium was worsening. So again, in this, we'll say that this child had efforts were increased with acidotic breathing. GCS was low, so that is an important finding. Pupils were not reacting to light. There was significant posturing. Blood sugar was very high. So this was again classified as primary brain dysfunction and resuscitation. There was no pallor, ictus, or clubbing. Anthropometry was preserved. There was not much in the respiratory or cardiac, but GCS has CNS has low GCS with not reacting pupils, increased tone, brisk reflexes, and extensive plantars. So this was probably a child with severe DK with symptomatic cerebral edema and raised ICP, probably herniated or not, we have to see. The blood sugar was high, ketones were high, and this was the blood gas we have. So Dr. Balaji, any comments on this? Though it looks simple, but just small comment.
Yeah, so this is a classical severe DK with cerebral edema. Now, what we need to know is why the kid has landed up in cerebral edema. Was there some concern with the fluid management or anything? Apart from that, there is severe hyponatremia as well, and we need to get a corrected sodium in these patients. So approximately it will come to 124 or 125, the corrected sodium as per the blood sugars of 300, if we say. So again, that is still very low, and severe acidemia, severe hyponatremia, all these predict the occurrence of cerebral edema, which is what has happened in this kid. So yeah.
Okay. So I think this blood gas looks simple. We can read out it's severe acidosis. There is significant metabolic acidosis, hyponatremia, and we have all the features pointing to DK on this. So it was managed on the line of DK with correction, IV insulin, raised ICP was managed for suspected infection. Ceftriaxone was given. The CRP was quite high. Procal was also very high. TLC was 18,000. Platelets were low. The blood and urine cultures were all sterile. So, and urea and creatinine were raised with the decreased urine output. So this was something which the other labs which we got. So what is the cause of persistent encephalopathy in this case, Dr. Suresh? And do we need to investigate that further?
Yeah, thank you, sir. So definitely this child had severe DK with cerebral edema. The risk factor for edema is longer duration of illness and severe acidosis, hyponatremia at presentation. The persistent encephalopathy after a few days could be related to disease per se, or its treatment related complications like DK in this child. Cerebral edema at presentation, and it could be due to complications of the treatment, like which lead to osmolar shifts inside the brain. So one group of diseases like related to disease or its treatment. So cerebral edema and its sequelae, or it may be intracranial thrombosis like cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, or there may be intracranial bleeds. These could be one group of diseases due to the disease-related and its treatment-related complications. But if there are other features of infection like elevated TLC or thrombocytopenia, elevated CRP, and fever is persisting, then I would also like to keep infections as one of the possibility, because these children are predisposed to develop infections in form of either bacterial infections or fungal infections.
Okay. So Dr. Dhiren, do you agree with whatever Dr. Suresh said? And also, how can we explain this high TLC and high infective marker, platelets are low, urea creatinine is raised? Is it common in DKs?
Diabetes means previous, say 20 years back, decay used to be having less complications. Now, over the time, I have found that these diabetic patients are more prone for complication, infectious complication, and while they recover, normal decay usually recover within 24-36 hours. That is a rule for most of the patients.
Yes.
In this patient, what I could see, this patient had catastrophic course at the onset, and almost probably he might have coned little bit, and brain coning might have happened. It looks like a patient developed some major catastrophe in the brain. Usually when we start treating them, and then they develop some brain edema, if you give bicarb, or but in this patient, it looks like patient had major catastrophe during admission mm-hmm. itself. Now, secondly, these patients are more prone for thrombosis. It's a hypercoagulable state. So I totally agree with Dr. Suresh that there is some major CNS problem is happening. Probably we should rule out some infectious complications because procalcitonin is high, patient platelet is persistently low, and you are given fungal. Now, what I have found that fungal infections are on rise in immunocompetent patients also. I could see the change in the pattern. Previously, most of the patients were getting higher antibiotics after, say, 7th, 10th day of ICU admission. Now I have found that 40-30% of the patients are getting immunocompetent patients are getting antifungal. So past 6 months, past 1 year, there is a change in the trend, and especially these patients are very prone for fungal, these diabetic patients.
Very true. Agreed. So almost everybody agree here that this is a decay with complications, and it is probably an infection related complication because of these high markers which we are having, and also affecting the kidneys and going into AKI. Yeah. So, and neuroimaging is required because of encephalopathy. So what are the common infections, Balaji, in DKA, which we see? One of these, Dr. Dhiren has already said, fungal infections. What are the others?
So, yeah, coming to fungal infections, common things like oral thrush, genital thrush, oral candidiasis, these are quite common, as well as mucor is one infection that is very dreaded, and any child with altered sensorium, even a small blackish, it could be as simple as a blackish discoloration in the nose or blackish discharge, then we always look out for invasive fungal infections, especially mucor in these patients. Apart from that, urinary tract infections are quite common, and soft tissue infections are quite common. So these are some of the common infections. And just a small comment on the labs in these patients. This kid obviously had elevated CRP, procalcitonin, thrombocytopenia, multiple things that pointed towards active infection going on. But elevated TLC as such is quite commonly observed in diabetic ketoacidosis, possibly dehydration and stress related. So if other pointers are not favoring an infection, and it's a straightforward child with just an elevated TLC, I would be really cautious in upfront initiating or suspecting active infection. Other markers don't correlate. But yes, in this kid, definitely not. This is a different story with other markers as well correlating. That's just the point I wanted to make.
Thank you, Dr. Balaji. Dr. Suresh, CT head was done, and the CT of the paranasal sinuses. So this is what we have. So can you comment on something on this? So this is the CT of the brain, and this is the paranasal sinuses.
Sir, the CT, this is the non-contrast CT head, which showed that there is a hyperdense lesion in the left thalamic region with the significant edema around the lesion. And
am I pointing it right?
Yes,
this is what you're talking about.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And this is the edema you are saying. Yes.
And in addition, there is gray white matter differentiation is well preserved in other areas, but we can't see any sulci and gyri, which are very they are not clearly visible. So there is definitely generalized cerebral edema plus hyperdense lesion in the thalamic area on the left side with edema. So it could be like it's possibly a bleed over there and surrounded by edema. The reason could be either it's a intracranial bleed in this location, or it could be secondary to venous sinus thrombosis leading to bleed. In sinuses, in the paranasal sinuses, CT, I'm not clear what is it, but maybe sphenoid sinuses are a little hazy, so there may be some soft tissue density in the sphenoid sinuses.
So this is again the CT of that. So this is the other cut in that, in which you have seen the in the left thalamic region, these ones you have, and the midbrain, you have frontal lobe and medial temporal lobe. There is significant blooming lesions which are seen here in these areas. So these are probably suggestive of vasculitic infarct with hemorrhagic areas, and could be, it was reported as probably an invasive fungal etiology in this case, that this is what was causing the problem in this child. So further workup in this, the other labs which we got was, Dr. Dhiren, we have this blood and urine cultures were sterile. Nasal scrapings of fungal smears were negative. We have beta D glucone 109, galactomannan of 2.5, HbA1c A1c expectedly was very high. And you have of the ultrasound, which was showing right pleural effusion, mild ascites, and there was some raised cortical echogenicity in the kidneys. So what do you how do you interpret this, basically this beta D glucone and galactomannan?
I don't have experience with the BD glucone, but a lot of patients for almost 10 years we get this galactomannan done. So first of all, I'll talk about what I'm experienced about. One is galactomannan. Yes. Second, it gives you some idea about invasive aspergillosis, but it's a very non-specific test, and we normally get it done in immunocompromised patients. And the problem is with this test is lot of cross reaction with the beta lactam antibiotic.
Yes.
One second, regarding BT glucagon, D-glycone, that is D-glucagon test, and this is usually a marker of pan fungal. Most of the fungal it covers, except mucormycosis. Mucormycosis it doesn't cover. And these are the blood tests, and actually we don't know the sensitivity in pediatric age group, but as I told you, D-glycone, I don't have my personal experience as compared to galactomannan.
So Balaji, you want to comment? Yeah,
Dr. Arun, in this type of scenario with this type of imaging, even if you are not able to prove you cannot get a brain biopsy done in these patients, these are the indirect markers which definitely help us in problem, this type of crux, difficult situation. And this is a life-saving situation and one should do everything. But these markers, especially galactomannan, I've seen that that helps in while treatment, the levels goes down. So that helps in chasing the patient and making the diagnosis. They are not very good tests.
Okay. So Balaji, you want to comment anything further on this two tests?
Yeah. So beta-13-D-glucan is actually a pan-fungal antigen. I think except for cryptococcus or something, it is usually seen in all fungi. And galactomannan is more specific for aspergillus. So whenever in this scenario, like the common fungal infections are, one is candida when mucocutaneous infection suspected, or if it is invasive CNS, it's usually mucor and aspergillus. These are the two things, especially when angio invasion is also there. So these are the two dreaded fungal infections that will be thought about. And with DKA, mucor takes an upper hand more than aspergillus. So the problem with diagnosing in these thing is obviously tissue diagnosis is what is needed, and many times when there is a brain involvement, we cannot get the proper tissue. If it's paranasal sinuses, then FES or something can be used. So these markers otherwise give a rough idea that there is a fungal infection going on.
So this child was started on liposomal amphotericin, thinking that mucormycosis is common in children with DKA and with the setting of acidosis and all these things, and the picture on CT scan which we had. And for AKI, peritoneal dialysis was given, and this child gradually improved. So Dr. Suresh, what are the common fungal infections in DKA?
Sir, common fungal infection, as Dr. Bala already told, that it could be mucormycosis or aspergillus infections are common, or it could be candida infection. The common locations are urinary tract, CNS, and lungs. So these are common locations to have fungal infections.
And why do fungal infections occur commonly in DK? We don't see in immunocompetent people usually fungal infections. Why only in these children?
So one more site is paranasal sinuses. The location may be just to start, I mean, infection may start from there and then that infection can travel to CNS. So paranasal sinuses could be a starting point for fungal infection, especially mucormycosis. In DK, because of prolonged acidosis, these children are predisposed to develop fungal infection, plus they are more prone to have various invasive procedures. And particularly with mucormycosis, what happens in DK is there is acidosis, and due to decreased pH, free iron is more inside the plasma, and there is decreased binding of iron to transferrin. So there is a lot of free iron inside the blood. And if there is any focus of this mucus inside the body or due to invasive procedure, if child had acquired mucus inside the body, then the proliferation of mucus is more in presence of free iron because it utilizes iron for its growth. So that's why these children are predisposed to develop mucormycosis.
Mucormycosis in them. So there has been one study from our unit in which we have seen that mucor is very common in children with type 1 diabetes. So majority of the time we have seen it's mucor, or very occasionally we have seen some other organism. So, and they have all been treated with amphotericin, and especially debridement of these lesion is very important. Otherwise, if you don't do the source control, they don't improve. And if done aggressively, you can have some reasonably good outcome in these cases. But mucus are known to spread very fast. So you have to be quite aggressive in these children. So like everybody has said, any role of in CNS fungal infections, we may not get the tissue to diagnose. So the other labs can play a role in that, like these biomarkers, which you have discussed, or any radiology or clinical features. So like clinical and radiologies are usually non-specific. So culture-based, we can't usually culture these funguses in the blood or from other body fluids. We can't get the biopsies. So galactomannan and 1,3-beta-D-glucan are the two tests which are available with us at present. So beta-D-glucan, as everybody has said, is a pan-fungal marker. And except mucormycetes and cryptococcus, it is tell you it is raised. Anything above 80 is considered as positive. But its utility, like Dr. Dhiren said, in children is limited with poorly established cutoffs. So we don't have much of the cutoffs. So we use the adult reference values only. And there can be false positives results in this, in bacteremia and like Dr. Dhiren said, meropenem, few other drugs, amoxiclav, and even albumin and immunoglobulin can give you a false positive result in these cases. Similarly, galactomannan is basically for Aspergillus, but like in this case, it was raised. Even in mucor also. So in this child, we have 1.27. So the sensitivity is different, and false positive results again can be seen with beta-lactams and beta-lactamase inhibitors. And false negative results can be even in Aspergillus if it is non-angioinvasive Aspergillus which is there. So this child was given antifungal therapy, came out from ventilator, was but required tracheostomy, but developed right hemiparesis, had on follow-up, right, a left chorioathetide movements and some improvement in cognitive function. So had left significant sequelae in this child. So coming forward, any comments, Suresh, Dr. Dhiren or Balaji on this? You want to share anything?
No, yeah. Mucor is bad. Mucor is bad.
It is, yeah.
Mucor, the cruxes, as you, Bansas are already suggested, first thing is early diagnosis. So when to suspect and how to diagnose it as early as possible. Second thing is, once diagnosed, extensive debridement, and apart from antifungal therapy, here liposomal amphotericin B will be the option. And apart from antifungal, it is like extensive tissue debridement that is going to save the child. So early diagnosis, suspicion early diagnosis and then extensive debridement along with antifungal, this is the only thing that is going to help in this child. And of course, treating the predisposition, like resolution of decay or any acidemic state. These are the possible 3-4 game changers whenever we have invasive mucor.
Thank you.
Just so one point, from, Dr. Arun, I have seen my personal experience I would like to share. Always look for the discoloration of the eyelids and the medial part, medial epicanthus.
Yes.
Means I've seen around 5 patients where invasive fungal infection started with sinus and affected the retroorbital area. And we could diagnose on ultrasound eye. But the starting point that the clinical clue was the discoloration of the eyelid, means there was swelling and proptosis of the eye and discoloration of the medial palpable part.
Yeah. That's a valid point. Practical tip, I think that's very important. So moving forward, so we have an 8-month-old child who had a chronic problem. So had a left leg swelling since 1 month, fever, and now developed fast breathing and irritability. So had a weight of 5.4 kg. So a 8-month-old child with 5.4 kg weight. Length 60, head circumference 41. There was pallor. You had tachypnea, respiratory distress, bilateral crabs. You had a liver and spleen, and left thigh was swollen and tender. So, what are the possibilities, Balaji? Could be in this case a long history, 8-month-old.
Yeah. So here the prominent pointers in the history and examinations. One is a young, infant. And the child has some poor weight gain, like 5.4 for an 8 kg. Now presenting with, again, a multi-system involvement with respiratory involvement, also having organomegaly and having a musculoskeletal involvement as well. One of the histories was like there was some family history of some malignancy. So upfront, one of the differentials that were considered is either a chronic infection or something like a malignancy that we are dealing with at this point of time.
Okay. So that was discussed. Can you comment anything on this X-ray, Balaji?
Yeah, so this child has already been intubated. Endotracheal tube is slightly deeper, close to carina. There is a bilateral lung infiltrates, right lower zone involvement, as well as left the entire upper zone, mid zone, retrocardiac. There are infiltrates and with few air bronchograms as well. So there is definitely bronchopneumonia with stomach distension and dilatation that is present. I'd also like to like the audience to have a look at this. The child had a left thigh swelling. So what we are seeing here is there is some involvement of the femur with there is a
this periosteal one, you're reaction. Talking about this thing?
Yeah. So there's a periosteal reaction and a periosteal elevation. So that could again point towards some chronic infection which is causing multi-system involvement. So there is evidence of pneumonia. There is also evidence of osteomyelitis at this point of time.
Dr. Dhiren, anything to add?
Yeah, it looks like some chronic infection that has spread suddenly. I mean, something was going on slowly, like staph is normally acute. I mean, this is some chronic infection that has spread. So my first thought process was looking at the case, is staph, and some acute on chronic event has happened.
Okay. So very rightly said that staph is very usually acute. This is 1 month history, so something more chronic is going on. So Dr. Suresh, the CT of the thigh was done. So can you comment anything on this?
Yeah. Yes, sir. So CT is showing that there is definitely thickening of the soft tissue or like muscles and subcutaneous tissues thickened. And there is the cortex of the femur is very irregular. And there is also periosteal reaction is there.
This is the one we are talking about. Yes.
Yeah. And there is some periosteal elevation, periosteal reaction. And these are the findings on the CT.
Okay. So, Dr. Balaji, we have this in...
Dr. Arun, yes. Just one point. Did somebody give intramuscular injection for vaccination at the thigh? Did we get
no history was there? No history was there about that.
Because I seen one patient of non-mycobacterium tuberculosis, like, you know, chronic infection, swelling, and then the things limited to the thigh only, didn't spread to the lung. So one or two patients I could get mm-hmm. that.
So we have now the labs, blood labs came as HB of 11, TLC was slightly raised, platelets were normal, and you have a hypochromic microcytic picture. CRP was okay, ESR was 3 millimeters. So did further investigation, sodium was slightly low, urea creatinine were normal, albumin was 3.1, HIV was negative. Ultrasound abdomen showed hepatosuplenomegaly. And there was a very interesting finding in the liver of heteroechoic lesion in the segment 4, which is quite big, 2 into 1.5 query abscess. So Dr. Balaji, anything, can you tell us about these few reports? So, are we getting near the diagnosis with these bloods?
Yeah, so these, the hematological parameters were totally bland with mild leukocytosis. Even the lymphocyte count, everything was normal. ESR and CRP, surprisingly, for the amount of the multi-organ involvement, did not show any elevation. Again, malnutrition is one thing. So in the background of malnutrition and failure to thrive, we need to take these inflammatory markers with a pinch of salt. Definitely, we are getting more involvement of even the visceral organs now. So initially we had lung involvement, then we have skeletal femur involvement. Now we have the involvement of liver as well. So in an acute setting, definitely staphylococcal infection is one thing which can present with this sort of setup. Even a chronic history, definitely chronic infections, chronic either fungal or tuberculosis etiology becomes more likely okay. when we have this multisystem.
So moving forward, like you said, this child had gone into respiratory failure, needed ventilation, was started on broad spectrum antibiotics, few investigations were pending. So what can be done to have a definitive diagnosis, Balaji?
Yeah, definitely this will need some tissue diagnosis because something chronic is going on. So,
Tissue? Do we need to poke the liver or we can get from the bone? No.
Yeah, I think the soft tissue infection, the femur, can be more accessible in a sick child whereas a liver biopsy will obviously entail more invasive and chance of bleeding risk, everything is there. So,
femur, yeah, very rightly said. So, biopsy from the femur was consistent with tuberculosis or osteomyelitis. So it showed fibrosis, histiocytes, necrosis, and few AFBs were seen. And the gastric aspirate also showed mycobacterium tuberculosis were detected. And even though the FNAC was negative in this case. So that's an interesting point that FNA may not yield in a very posy bacillary tuberculosis. So you might need biopsy in this case. Dr. Dhiren, you want to comment anything on this?
Yeah, I think one is the endotracheal aspirate, if possible. Secondly, liver aspiration bedside in a very sick patient is more feasible than biopsy from the femur.
Yes.
And gastric aspirate, you rightly said that we tend to, you know, undermine these non-invasive tests and go for the fancy stuff first. So I think just one point I want to make that liver test, liver biopsy, liver aspiration, bedside ultrasound guided are very safe, very simple to perform than very invasive tests.
Okay. So in segment 4, can we get it done? Is it easy to reach there?
Yeah, it's no problem. It's no possible. Problem. Yes.
So
yes.
That's tightly said. So it's not a deep seated with segment 4, we can get it done.
Yeah.
So we are short of time. So we have a couple of more cases to discuss. They are also very interesting ones. So we'll move forward. So this is a 17-month-old child who had presented again with fever, rash, loose motion, difficulty in breathing, presented with gasping respiration. TLC was high, platelets were low, started on ceftriaxone and clindamycin, also had AKI with high creatinine, CRP was very raised. And X-ray is showing a mild right-sided pleural effusion here. And ET aspirate had grown staph aureus, which was sensitive to Benko, Tico, Ceftron, which was resistant to Clinda. It's basically resistant to that. So what do you make out of it, Dr. Dhiren? And this was the MALDI-TOF ET secretion, ET aspirate, which showed staph aureus, which was resistant to all these organisms, but sensitive to vancomycin, but resistant to penicillin.
Yeah, very surprisingly that it is resistant to clindamycin. It looks like a community-acquired infection one. History matches, there's a rapid onset. So staph aureus can be an organism which can lead to all these clinical signs and symptoms. Thirdly, staph aureus, which is resistant to clinda, normally it is sensitive to clindamycin because it is a community acquired, but nowadays doesn't follow the rule every time. But in any case, we need a bactericidal drug. So teicoplanin, I would like to choose. One is, if you ask me, antibiotic. Secondly, regarding other labs, creatinine is high, CRP is pretty high. So this patient is going to land up in, you know, this will take time to recover, and it's a life-threatening situation.
Yes, true. So Dr. Suresh, how common is community-acquired MRSAs?
Yes, sir. Yeah, community-acquired MRSA is very, like, it's increasing these days, and past few years we are seeing more and more number of children with community-acquired MRSA, and these commonly present with skin soft tissue infections and pleuropulmonary infections. So various studies have documented that community-acquired MRSA accounted for around 15 to as high as 30% of community-acquired staph aureus. So in recent years, the incidence is increasing.
Very true.
Nowadays, it's around 40%.
40 to 50%, yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, so teicoplanin was added. After 6 days, he improved, was extubated, but inspiratory stridor was persisting, which required BiPAP. But before extubation, endotracheal aspirate had was taken because there were purulent secretion and fever was present. So we had grown Acinetobacter, and the Gram stain showed many polymorphonucleosides. So Acinetobacter was there, which was resistant to many of the organisms, many of the drugs. So Dr. Dhiren, what should be the next course as stridor is persisting, but chest X-ray is normal and TLC is slightly raised?
This is a situation where we need to decide, should I give antibiotic considering as a VAP, or should I just ignore this because the patient has been successfully extubated. Other than stridor, there must not be very high oxygen requirement as patient is on BiPAP. TLC is 18,000. That can be well explained by your staff, because in staff it takes time. So at this situation, I want more information about the chest X-ray. How is the chest X-ray? Secondly, whether
it's normal. Chest X-ray, we didn't find any abnormality.
How the child is doing over next 24 hours, that is very important. Because any worsening, I would give the benefit of doubt to the patient. But if child is improving, I may consider to be as a ventilatory associated tracheitis, because not a pneumonia, because chest X-ray, if it is normal, oxygen requirement is not there. So I would like to treat it as a case of ventilatory associated tracheitis. And also at stridor, looking at the scenario over next 36 hours, I would like to give antibiotic if patient is deteriorating, but if patient is improving, I would like to wait in this patient.
Okay, great. So Dr. Suresh, do you want to comment on this colony count, role of colony count in ET aspirates for labeling it as VAP or ventilator associated or endotracheal tube associated pneumonia? So this 40,000 of Acinetobacter, is it significant?
Hello.
Yes, please.
Sir, this the colony count is like 4 × 10⁴, which is not significant count for samples from ET aspirate. So, if the clinical picture is not fitting into VAP, as Dr. Dhiren mentioned, so I won't consider this as a cause of VAP in this child.
Yeah. So the important message,
Dr. Arun, just one thing.
Yeah.
When patients are receiving a lot of antibiotics. Fine.
Yes.
And at times we may not get that magical figure of 10⁵.
Yes.
In ET aspirate on in the bell. So what Suresh said is perfect, that one should look for the clinical criteria other than just 40. So 40,000, nor you can ignore if patient starts deteriorating.
Yes.
Nor you should take is as a just a, you know, a clear cut case of ventilatory associated tracheitis or pneumonia. So I mean to say 40,000 figure, we cannot ignore if patient has received antibiotics.
Exactly. So if the child is running high grade fever, worsening of respiratory distress, X-ray is bad, then this 40,000 also is very significant. But if he's did not show any further deterioration, like Dr. Dhiren said, I'll observe for 24 hours. And if he's stable, so we can hold on the antibiotics and it may just be a colonizer rather than a true infection. So that is an important message for which we have taken up this case. So coming to the last case, a child 4 months old had received a vaccine and developed shock and fever, was intubated, also had a cardiac arrest for which given CPR in an outside hospital, then was transferred after he had received meropenem, was in cardiac failure, required high frequency oscillator, inotropes, developed renal failure for which peritoneal dialysis was given and was continued on meropenem. So this was the story we had. The endotracheal aspirate, again, the biofire had grown multiple organisms, Dr. Dhiren, in this. We had Acinetobacter, we had Enterobacter, we had Klebsiella, we had Staph aureus, we had Staph pneumoniae, and what all in this. So how do we make out of this in the biofire? We have a full vegetable garden in this.
You know, this similar looking case we also had, and at that time, I was a little bit confused looking at the similar looking report. So what I thought that let me go clinically and the type of antibiogram we had in our ICU. So looking at the colony count, the colony count, which are very high, say 10^4+, means 10^5, maybe in pathogenic organisms. Again, too much reading this report, this patient may end up in over-treatment. So what I would like to do, I would like to see my own antibiogram, type of bacteria, type of viruses we have in past, prevalent in our past 6 months, past 1 year. Based on that, I would like to target Acinetobacter. Second, because patient had difficult intubation and CPR and also, so I would like to cover MRSA. So these two bugs I would like to cover out of these based on the clinical scenario, not going by the report, because this is an PCR. PCR will detect very minuscule amount of dead virus or bacteria that can be represented as an infection in these given reports.
Perfect. So that is very important. So we should not be chasing the labs. We have to correlate it with clinically and your past antibiogram growing in these cases. So what will you do, Dr. Dhiren, in this? Like what you said?
As I told you that I would like to give colistin and teicoplanin. With colistin, I would like to give one more because I feel that alone colistin covering Acinetobacter is not a good, good thing.
Okay. So we again then did an ET aspirate which grew Acinetobacter, which was sensitive to colistin. And so colistin was also added to this. And how much reliable these PCR reports are and what should be our next step in this case, sir?
As I told you, PCR reports gives you almost all sort of DNA and RNA which are present in the endotracheal tube, whether they are colonizer, whether they are commensals. So that is the problem with the PCR. So we need to correlate with the clinical presentation, your scenario, where the patient is, and the blood reports and other labs has to be played with the PCR. One should be very cautious in starting treatment based on just on PCR.
Yeah. So these could be, means we have to be very careful to see whether they are colonizers or not. With the low colony count, and we don't grow anything on culture, probably it's a colonizer. And if you have a multiple nucleic acid targets in low counts may also be indicative of colonizers, or normal respiratory flora may also be picked up on these PCRs because they are very sensitive tests, these BioFires and all. So they do not correlate with bacterial culture in colony counts only. So colistin was added, like you said, it is important based on this progress. So the child had, based on his clinical course. So was it a right step, Dr. Suresh or Balaji, you want to comment on this, or we could have added any other drug?
Sir, if we suspected VAP in this child based on clinical feature, deterioration in oxygenation and radiological evidence plus other lab investigations, and even at that point of time, we could have treated for ventilator-associated pneumonia based on what organism we see in our unit which causes VAP. So like in our unit, we cover for Acinetobacter. If we suspect that VAP is definitely there based on clinical and radiological investigation, then we add colistin. But yeah, we don't see...
The organism was sensitive to both colistin and TG cycline.
Yeah, I think colistin is okay. I mean...
Okay, yeah. Okay. So how can we give any Dr. Dhiren or Dr. Balaji colistin, then some tips to this so that this is can be more efficacious?
Yeah, Dr. Balaji, yeah.
Yeah, colistin, especially when we are dealing with that, there is also a role of adding a nebulizer.
Dr. Balaji, your sound has become again childish.
Is it better now or
now it's an adolescent soil sound. You okay. Go ahead.
Yeah. So with especially ventilator associated pneumonia, along with intravenous colistin, there is also an option of adding an add-on therapy of nebulized colistin in along with the IV colistin when we deal with VAP. So that is one strategy that can be followed. And another thing is like a prolonged infusion of colistin is one more thing that has been advocated. So these are some things that can be tried.
So I think we have had some good cases
one,
and good discussion.
One comment, any one point? Comment, Dr. Yes. Arun?
Yeah.
You know, I was a few days back, I was reading about the colistin synergism.
Yes.
In past two decades, we are left with just one effective antibiotic, that is colistin. Fine, especially for Acinetobacter with the advent of NDM. Okay, now this NDM is not a problem of West. So they have Avibactam combination with the Ciftazidime that doesn't work with our Acinetobacter. Now, how to deal with? So to increase the synergism of colistin, they say that you can add another antibiotic which has got synthetic effect, means something like that suppresses protein synthesis. Okay, so what they do, they have tried to use combination like some antibiotic like minocycline, some antibiotic like TG cycline they didn't mention, but they have used antibiotic like vancomycin. What these antibiotic does that the colistin decreases, increases the permeability of outer cell, the cell yes. membrane, that lipid A moiety, it leads to saponification. Now antibiotic like meropenem, we know that there is a sensitivity, there is a synergism with meropenem and other antibiotic, but I am talking about something very different. So yes. The vancomycin can enter the cell and can act against gram-negative bacteria.
Yes.
Why in previous few years these antibiotic couldn't act against gram-negative? Because they couldn't enter the gram-negative bugs.
Yes.
So they are trying that if we combine colistin with some these antibiotics, probably because now they can enter it. Enter the cell, so they may work. Also, in some form of colistin, they say that even if it's a colistin resistant, I mean, now they are talking about colistin resistance. At
yes.
subclinical level, it leads to saponification to that extent that antibiotic can penetrate inside the cell, may not colistin work, but other antibiotic will start working. So this is a newer concept.
Newer concept.
Which is the microbiologists are working on it. I think over the time we'll come to know.
Great. Any other comments, Balaji or Suresh, before we hand it over to the host?
Yeah, sir, regarding the case 3, other possibility could be the fungal infection, the child with thigh swelling and lung involvement. So previously, Dr. Rose discussed about various fungal infection which could present like similar presentation. So that could be one
possibility. I agree. And especially once it was worked up, like Dr. Balaji has put up in the chat box, this case was given by Dr. Balaji. It was a case of immunodeficiency only. So tuberculosis and fungal infections are common in them.
Yeah, okay. It was turned out to
as combined
immunodeficiency.
Yeah, Dr. Balaji, I was listening to the previous presentation where the myelidosis was one of the case in the pot spine. Fine. Recently, we had a case of myelidosis presenting as an ARDS and it affected the brain. Culture grew, not only blood culture, urine culture, as well as CSF culture. All culture grew myelidosis. And everything patient survived, but the brain got the major brunt and he became brain dead.
Yeah. Okay, so I think we are now taken almost 1 hour for this panel discussion. And I think Dr. Narmada, hope we were able to do justice to the topic of playing with the lab. So we tried to use some of the lab parameters and correlate it with the clinical course. I hope you all liked it. Thank you, Dr. Rajendran and Dr. Narmada for giving us the opportunity. And thank you. I thank all the panelists for amazing, engaging discussion.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Arun. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Now I request our secretary, Dr. Rajendran, sir, to give a vote of thanks. Before that, Rajendran, sir, before that, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you first. For giving us such a freedom for us as a coordinator for myself and Dr. Narmada. Really, no one will do these things. We are zero interference from the TNSE and we are so supportive.